Hi, Alan Stratton from As Wood Turns. This video is about a journey that I've had, a journey of threading. Years ago, I wanted to thread boxes. I looked at commercially available jigs and I said, ooh, I can't afford those. I looked at hand chasers such as these and said, they take a lot of skill and special wood. Maybe I can design my own. And so I sat down and worked out the principles of a thread cutting jig. And I hit a roadblock, and that is I couldn't get from commercially available all thread to my chuck. And by the time I had a machinist machine that special part for me, I may as well buy a commercial jig. But then last May at the Utah Woodturning Symposium, a presenter by the name, I believe, of Dennis Paullus presented making an acorn type box, very nice. But he also used a threading jig, and he gave us out a parts list of that and how he had sourced those, including a critical component, which is this guy right here. This is an adapter from 3/4 16 TPI here on the all thread to 1/8 for a chuck. So I sourced those parts, and meanwhile, Christensen at the Golden Spike Club demonstrated how he had set his up, which was a good refresher. Thank you, Grant. So now I've actually got it working. So this project will be where my first successful threads, which are into this, that is not really a box because I was practicing threading. But I thought I'd demonstrate this so that maybe you can avoid the same roadblock I had. The parts to this setup are all thread and nuts. This is 3/4 16 all thread, about a foot of it, and 5 3/4 16 nuts to go on it. Two of those support it in a vise. One backs up against this adapter, and the other two hold on a hand wheel that I've turned. This adapter was the key component, but now I know where to get it. The other part of the jig is the cutter. And that consists of a small cutter, 3/8 inch diameter, a mandrel. This is a number 2 Morse taper mandrel to fit the 3/4 into, that then goes into the Morse taper, and then have to use a drawbar on this or it will come out and do damage to projects and to people. So the safety point is drawbar, use it tight. So this is then mounted on a XY vise. I went to the local low-cost, sloppy-fit hardware store and bought this. It's sloppy tolerances, but it's adequate for the job. Actuality, you only need the top part, but if you were to buy something of just the top part, you'd probably spend more than the whole thing. So this will do the job as an XY vise. So with this mounted, I'll show you all how it works, but my chuck then mounts here on the end of this. This all thread advances into the cutter to cut the thread. One thing that's handy is that others have recommended is a denture brush to clean the threads with, because it's stiffer than a toothbrush. I have this all mounted on a piece of MDF with a piece to go in between the ways of this lathe. And I hold it in place with a couple of mag switches so that I can slide it back and forth. In use, I put it close and then I bring the banjo up to register the point at which I'm beginning, because as I make a pass, back it off, I then have to see whether it's adequate yet or not. And then bring it back up against the banjo, make another pass, back it off, inspect, and so on. One critical element to this setup is using thin CA to stabilize the wood. The dense woods that we can use hand chasing tools on are already dense. They're already very stiff and very nice for hand chasing threads. Most woods such as this won't hold a thread by themselves very well. So the other element that makes this thing work is the use of CA. Now, I've already had a debate with someone on how much CA to use. For this, I used CA on the raw wood and then CA just before the final pass, as you'll see in the video, on both the female and the male portions. Another person said, well, you don't need to do the pretreatment because you're going to cut it all off. Well, that can be true too. In my opinion, it depends on your wood. If your wood is quite brittle, then you want to treat it up front, and probably with every pass you want to refresh it so that your cutter can actually cut through wood without chipping it and ruining your thread. Then at the very end, then at least by then, put a little more CA on, make another final pass at the same setting, and we're good to go.
This wood is gum harvested from my yard a couple of years ago. Previously, I roughed it round and cut tenons on both ends. Now I need to part my cylinder to form a top and bottom. For a true box, I'd normally hollow the top at this point. Since the top is already in the chuck, I'll drill it next with a Forstner bit. Thinking about whether the sides need to be parallel, I don't think so. The threading cutter will make them parallel before it is finished. Of course, a Forstner bit inherently cuts parallel sides. I treated the interior with a good dose of thin CA glue and let it harden thoroughly. Time to assemble the cutter into the lathe spindle. The collet has to be held with a drawbar. The collet, in turn, holds the cutter. Not using a drawbar is asking for an accident with a bad ending. Next, to mount the threading jig onto the lathe. I'm leaving it loose until later. When things are in good relative position, I lock down the banjo to serve as a stop. I'll need to pull back the jig to check progress. The banjo will enable me to return to the same spot. I'm first checking to see if the bit travels parallel to the outside. If it can do that, it should be parallel on the inside. Now for the first pass with the cutter barely touching the inside. I want to take this gradually. The hand wheel is a decent size to gradually advance the wood. At the bottom, I crank the wood back out. This time, I'm advancing the cutter depth just a little, since I obviously have a lot to go. It's a test, but does not seem to bother the cutter. Then another pass a little deeper. At the end of this pass, I inspect the threads and see flat tops. This means I need to cut more until they have sharp peaks. After another pass, I think I'm close. I took a break to apply thin CA glue to the fresh threads. The CA glue should give the thread some strength. Then one last pass at the same setting to clean out the CA glue without cutting the threads any deeper. Now the top is almost done, but I have to do some cleanup. Since the mini lathe is mounted onto my big lathe, I'm having to disassemble the cutter from the spindle so I can use the lathe. The cleanup on the top amounts to cutting a chamfer to help threads start to engage easier. A little cleanup on the lip, a light sanding of the threads to ease the sharp point, then I'm applying my beeswax and mineral oil mix for lubrication. Now for the base part. If a box, I would need to hollow now. I need to cut a tenon to fit the threads on the top. This means it must be larger than a measure of the top. While I could do some math, I know I just need to get a little too large. The cutter will take care of cutting it down to size. So while I am using a caliper, I'm adding an eighth of an inch to be safe. The final task is to cut a shallow valley that the cutter can end in. Then reassemble the cutter, move the jig into approximate position, and lock down the banjo. I'm ready for pass one for the tenon, then slide back the jig to test the threads. They don't fit, and I'm glad they don't. If they fit, I'd have cut it too close. Pass two and test, not a fit. Crank in the jig just a smidgen, again, not a fit. Pass three and test, not a fit, but getting closer. I have to be careful not to overshoot. My vise is crude compared to what I really need. Still, it works if I'm careful. Pass four and test, getting closer. Only small fractions of rotation, and watch out for backlash. I always turn in one direction. Pass five and test, just a little bit more, turn the crank about 10 degrees. Pass six and test, the threads engage and seem to be fine. It's hard to start because there is not yet a chamfer on the end. I'll stop now and apply some CA glue to strengthen these threads, accelerator to get the glue harder faster, and a final pass at the same setting to clean off excess CA glue. A quick retest shows that all is well. Not too tight, not too loose. Then disassemble the cutter so that I can use the lathe again. The threads cut deeper than my little gully I cut earlier. I need to cut a little deeper to allow clearance for the end threads and chamfer off the first thread. While this is not an official box, I think I'll shave off the exterior but leave the tenons to show how it was mounted. It's good enough to sign and apply a little oil and wax mix for lubrication.
This project is complete. It's my first successful threaded, almost a box. I did not hollow it out, so it doesn't count as a box. But I only wanted to make sure I could thread before I went to the extra work of making a box. I did wax the threads to make them more easily threaded. And I have not taken the time to align the grain. The grain does not match on that. That's almost another video in itself. So another time we can talk about matching the grain. My plan for the future, I'll get good at these eventually, and I'll use those for when I have the exotic woods and for small projects where this doesn't fit well too. So these are still there, available in the future. I plan to use them, but for other common woods that are more readily available and less expensive, I'm going to use this setup mounted on my traveling lathe that I don't use that often, and I think I can thread it. So make sure you wear your face shield. These cutters can throw chips in your eyes. So this is Alan Stratton from As Wood Turns.